Oi, you. It's time for another episode of Dorothy and the Dealer. Let's tune into the conversation.
Hey, how are you going, Richie?
Good, buddy.
How are you going today?
I'm good, mate. How are you going today?
I'm good. What is that about?
Well, I mean, we've been here for hours. Why are we saying how are we going today? Well, are we pretending to people?
No, we're supposed to be authentic, mate. It's a new day for when people are listening to it. So how are you going? That's all I'm asking.
I'm good, mate. I'm good. The hemorrhoids have been playing up, but other than that, I'm okay.
Oh, dear. Okay, well, then that's enough of that. We won't have that conversation anymore. I'm really excited today because we are getting to interview one of our beautiful clients who lives in Melbourne, and every single time we ask her to do something with us and have a chat with us, she's always up for it. And I'm really excited to share your story. I actually talk about your story a lot. So, Caroline Arthur, hi. I'm going to call you Kaz anyway. Hi.
Kaz.
Please do. Hi, guys. How are we?
Good, mate.
We're not allowed to ask that, are we?
Oh, no. Apparently we're not.
No, don't ask that.
You two sound like a married couple that have been in ISO together for a very long time.
Yes, it feels like that too, mate.
We have been friggin' locked down. Is it bad that when you go to sleep, you're visualizing murdering someone? Is that a bad thing?
I'm just working out which pillow to use at the moment.
Is it going that well, is it?
Oh, it's amazing.
It's excellent. Bringing up all the challenges.
I know.
No, we're doing all right.
Oh, that's good. All right. Well, before we start, we've got to get, as we normally do, your favourite song or what you're listening to at the moment. What are you listening to at the moment, Kaz?
At the moment, I've been doing my workouts. I'm starting with a song called Purple Hat by Sophie Tucker.
Oh,
right.
How does that go?
Are you going to hum it for us or sing it for us?
Oh, God. I didn't know. I was going to have to do that. It's a very quick rap. So,
you can do this.
Hang on.
Don't bother her. Leave it be.
I can't even think of the words. No, I've got nothing for you.
I'm trying to
get it up so I can play it. It's a really cool tune. My Mitch, you would like it a lot.
I'll have to check it out.
It's a beady tune, is it? Would we know it?
Yeah, you would. I'm sure your kids would know it too, Mitch. They would have to.
Purple Hat. It's a festival tune, is it?
Yeah.
I don't let them go to festivals yet, mate. They're only 10.
I don't know. Can you hear that? No, probably not.
Try it.
Play it. Go on. Have we got it?
Yeah. Bear with me. No, it's not coming up. God, sorry, guys.
No, we can actually hear that. That was good. Like dancing on the people. Oh, that's cool, man.
Cool.
I thought it was that song, you know, you can stay if you want to.
I've got to turn it off. Hang on, bear with me.
That's all right. If your friends don't dance, and if they don't dance, well, they ain't no friends of mine, you know.
It's a totally different song.
I know, like, but really, I tell you, know, you
can see. It's what made you.
Remember their hats. Remember their hats.
Oh, yeah. Anyway.
You're back on, Kaz.
Back on.
All right, guys.
Let's just get stuck into it because we want to chat because you've got lots to talk about. We've got lots to talk about when we talk about your story. So, I suppose.
How did you meet us?
Let's start with that.
How did you fall into this craziness?
Yeah, well, I was trying to think of how long ago it was earlier today. I think my son Cooper was 3 and he's now 16. Mm. So, I think that's roughly the timeline. And I was having quite a few, I was struggling within myself, within my marriage. In most areas that I looked at, I felt like I probably wasn't doing very well. And I was looking for something. I was looking for answers. I was looking for something to point me in the right direction. I was going to a marriage counsellor and looking for things, talking to people. And one of my friends at the time, one of my other mothers from the school that my children were at, Cheryl Lee.
Cheryl
was talking to me and she said, look, you know, if you're looking for this, and it just resonated with me for whatever reason. And she was talking, she said, come along to one of the info nights. And I was very resistant. I was like, you know what, I've got nothing to lose at this point. We'd been to a counsellor the day before and she basically told me I had it all worked out and there was nothing to worry about, but I knew that wasn't the case. For whatever reason, I was there and sat in that seat and it really I can, you know, obviously now looking back that many years and it resonates in my life still, as you know, every single day. For both me and my husband, but was very resistant at the start, and particularly Cam as well. But yeah. I said to him, listen, buddy, we're doing this as a package deal, and, you know, we're going to go and have a listen. And that's where it started.
That was an info night, wasn't it? Because I don't think we were running Mastermind and Money back then. It was
No, that wasn't even thought of then.
Yeah, yeah, so you just came in to find out about relationships and you and figure out what's that. And then you booked in and away we went. Yeah,
that's it. We did the first relationships and you and then, went on from there, went on to do all of it.
So what was happening in your life? Like, obviously, marriage, what was going on that you – were you looking for something? Like, what was happening?
Well, I had a 2- or 3-year-old and a 5-year-old at the time, and basically had given up all of my values, which is, you know, we can talk in these terms now, but at the time I didn't recognize that, but had lost myself completely. So was waking up in the morning. I was asking permission, you know, me, Mitch and Mills, I was asking permission to go to the movies with a friend to my husband, and he was saying no. And I was not doing it, you know,
oh my God.
That's where I was at. And I worked out, you know, looking back, my mum was the quintessential housewife and she loved that. That was her role. Mm. And so I thought that that had to be me, you know, and I tried that hat on and was trying to do this at home mother thing. It's never been my gig and it wasn't ever going to be, but I tried it on and was trying to make something fit that didn't fit it. And so that caused then problems in my marriage, which I didn't realize, well, how can my husband find me attractive if I don't even like myself? Yeah. You know, I was not showering, not taking any pride in my appearance, not doing any of the things that of what he fell in love with and, you know, couldn't even look at myself in the mirror and be happy. So that flowed onto every, you know, I couldn't be a good mother. I couldn't be, you know, I wasn't fulfilling anything or feeling like I was doing a good job at anything.
Right. Yeah.
It's funny that lineage thing, isn't it? It's funny that, you know, we see it all the time. My God, you know, it's that, you know, when people get that the first struggle is really with the lineage, you know, that we do what our parents did because we think that that's, the so we're not actually, thing. We're not actually thinking for ourselves, you know, there's no concept of you're not yourself. You know, when people say, you're not yourself, it's because you fucking aren't yourself.
No.
You know, you think you actually have to be someone else and you think, you know, well, this is what mom did and this is how this had, you know, potentially damaging the whole lineage thing can actually be, you know, when we lose our independence, a man turns up in our lives and we kids turn up and we just give up everything and we think that that's what we're meant to fucking do. And it's like, no, that's not what you're meant to do at all.
And I think it's equally works the other way when we try and do, when we think we need to do the same thing and also when we try not to do the same thing, it's equally as detrimental because we're either trying to be it or trying to not be it, but it's the same pull, you know, at the end of the day.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Either way, you're not being true to yourself. You're trying to be something or trying not to be something. Yeah, absolutely. And I felt a pull from Cam as well because he thought that he wanted that as well, but he didn't realise as well that that wasn't what he wanted. That wasn't who he fell in love with. That woman wasn't. She'd gone away, exited the building.
Yeah. Isn't it funny how all that happens? And like, it just so the audience gets an understanding, like Cam is, you know, he's your stereotypical Aussie bloke, you know, he fucking speaks like this, mate, and that's just fucking how it is how it is. And so, I mean, you know, it was actually quite lovely to have the both of you in the audience. Yeah. And I also have to say that, you know, there must have been, I mean, you were both fighting for your marital lives. You know,
we really were.
Yeah, and when I look back on your relationship, it's such a unique thing because that's exactly what was going on. You were both struggling very hard to try and keep it together for the sake of the kids because you loved each other, but you weren't yourselves loving each other. You'd both become someone else.
Mm. Yeah. And I can honestly say too, you know, if without the skills that we learnt, we wouldn't be here today. Like together, we would be still here on the earth, but I don't believe we would be together as a unit without the skills that we learnt. And, you know, every day we choose to be together now, but I don't know in 5 years or 5 days or whatever, but, you know, we make a conscious effort every day of being here together and we've got some, you know, some mad skills now to make those decisions every day.
Because it's ultimately not about saving a relationship or not. It's about you being the best example of you, him being the best example of him, and then, you know, choosing, like you said, to have that relationship. And I think that's important. So what did you get as a result of doing that and being in relationships in you? What was the What was that moment like for you? What was the realization, or what came about as a result of that?
There was several for me, and I don't know if you remember, Mills, but I remember the process for me was, it wasn't as, mind-blowing as it, the physical things you see, some people, the reactions and things, and I at the start was like, oh, am I not getting this? What's going on for me here? And there's so many things, because I'm that type of person that wants to get it so hard, and I'm trying to put pressure on myself because I'm like, right, I will get this today. I'm smart. I know all this stuff. I'm going to get all this stuff. But you can't force you can't force what the process is going to be, and it will come. And for me, it came later on. And even I reckon my biggest moment was after I went back and did logistics. I had so many moments before that, and you asked me what I got. I got myself, Mills. That's what I got. I actually got Kaz, and I got a an understanding and a love for myself, and I got to know that I am more important than anybody else. And if I do me, everybody else around me will be just fine.
Yeah.
But I didn't get that for some time. Yeah, that's a massive thing for mums to get, though, as a general rule, because, we're generalizing, but it's something that we see a lot of. It's that, as soon as women become mothers, they feel like they've got to give themselves up, and this is a lineage thing as well, right?
Yeah.
They feel like they've got to give themselves up for the benefit of the kids, and then they lose themselves. And then, when we tell them that you've got to put yourself first, people think that that means that you don't care about the others, but it actually means you care more about the others because you filled your cup first, and then you've got something to give. Otherwise, you're just giving from an empty well, and that's impossible.
Yeah. Well, I think you realize. When you understand who you are, you realize the role that you actually play here as a human, you realize that, hold on, no, I'm as much of a student as I am a teacher, and as much of a teacher as I am a student. And the only way to truly teach people is you have to be a walking example of how you want other people to be.
And I remember being horrified, Mitch, when you stood up in front of me and you asked that question, and we had to write down on a piece of paper who we would put first, second, I still remember that moment. And I remember my husband, Cam, writing himself, putting himself, and he always did that. Yeah. And I was always condemning him for that, always. So I was like, you are a selfish prick. You're putting yourself first. You should be putting all of us first. And I still remember being horrified when you said that. Yeah. And that was a moment for me. That was a big moment.
Yeah, Where Cam was like, yes,
I've got it right.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah.
Screw you, Cam. See, I should be up there lecturing this room right now.
We've got so many stories that I want you to share with our listeners if we can, but after that moment, I think that just was impactful for your relationship, right? And so you guys started to become yourselves, and then that was cool. Then you came along, you did some other seminars with us, and I know you wrote your mission statement with us, and you you went and did that, and then you carried on to do some more work, and then I want to share, if we can, the story of your mission statement and what happened when you – I remember you coming in and visiting us, but I'll let you tell the story, go on.
Yeah. So I worked on this mission statement and refined it and sat down, and I was trying to work out if it's right or wrong, and, eventually got it down, talking about what I thought that it needed to be. And then I went back to – I had a little break from it and hadn't been going back and checking it and rereading it, and I went back to it, and I don't know if we had spoken or something, Mills, and you said I must have been a bit stalled or something was – I was a bit stuck, and you said, do me a favour, go back and reread your mission statement. And so I went back and I read it, and I was reading this mission statement, which I hadn't read for quite a few months, and I was reading it. As I was reading it, I was like, right, so – I've written on there I was wearing glasses and had always had bad eyesight, that about having laser eye surgery, that was on there. Then I'd talked about moving house and building this dream house. I described the kitchen, what it looked like, what everything on this, everything on there had – went back to this mission statement after a long time, and everything on there had been ticked off, and to the point of I can't even tell you the detail in it. It was quite mind blowing. And I remember going in there to you and just showing you, and you said, go and highlight all the things on there. and everything, the whole page was basically highlighted. And that was what, when also I realized that I needed to rewrite my mission statement because I ticked everything off.
Yeah, because I remember you coming in and you'd said, this was about 7 years ago now, and you'd come in and you'd said, Mills, I've just come in. I just came in to have a chat with you guys, and you just said to me, "Oh, I just wanted to say thank you because I've just ticked the last thing off my mission statement, right? Which was, I think, the car, an Audi. And then I remember because I had people around me, and I remember thinking, "Oh, that's a problem," but I didn't say anything to you because I think there were people around me, and I was like, hasn't she been like adjusting it? Because we hadn't seen each other, we'd been only seeing each other on and off. And I'm like, hasn't she been adjusting it? I must speak to her about that. And then I didn't get a chance to speak to you properly about that. And then a month later, it was beginning of November, there was a Melbourne Cup, right? And you said you'd been experiencing, as a result of having ticked everything off, I think you said you'd been experiencing some weird thoughts and some weird stuff going on. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, you've got a good memory.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was like, I guess that was, I don't know, all these things were happening to force me into to basically re-looking at it and going, what's going on here?
What do I want to do with my life kind of thing,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, where do I want to go? What's happening? Like, I was questioning everything because I felt like I had no purpose, basically, again. And I spoke to you, I think, Mills, and said, I don't know what's going on. And you referred me back to that again and said, you need to have a look at you need to have a look at your mission statement again. And then I had another look at it, but I was really lost again in my direction of my life. Was that when I went back? It was November, you're right, Mills. And then
I remember because it was my 40th birthday, Kaz.
That's right, yeah. So I went to the races and was Derby Day. And that day I got home the next day and had a very, very big headache and didn't know what was going on. And Cameron said, "You've had too many champagnes. You've had a big day. You're being a baby. Don't worry about it." Anyway, after 3 days, the headache got worse. It turns out I had 3 cerebral brain aneurysms, and I needed to have emergency brain surgery that day. So that was a big moment for me because I had basically inadvertently, what I realize now is I'd asked for that. I had felt no connection to a lot of places, a lot of things, wasn't in touch with my own mission statement, and I'd spoken to Millsy, as you said, and I didn't have a purpose or an answer. And I also had felt that I wasn't connected to my husband and that I didn't feel like he was loving me the way that I wanted to be loved. And on so many levels, this it took me out. It definitely took me out, and it changed the way that I look at everything, my whole life, changed the colours of things, changed the way that I smelled things, changed the way that I tasted things, changed my life, basically. And I think I spoke to you. I must have just been out of hospital, Mills.
It was, it was, like I said, it was around the time of my birthday, and I remember you were in hospital, and I think I called you while you were in hospital, just as you'd come out. Yeah. And I remember saying to you, the thing with the mission statement is people think it's a finite thing and that it stops and it's not supposed to stop, it's supposed to keep going. It's not supposed to be like, oh, this is my tick list, I'm just going to tick these things off. And I was and then I remember thinking at the time, and I remember thinking, oh, Millsy, why didn't you say anything to her, when you spoke to her? But there's no mistakes. And I think and I think that it's also really important for people to hear what you're saying, in the sense that, when we talk about the fact that we take responsibility for what happens around us and in our lives and stuff like that, it's a matter of like not saying, that's not about shouldering blame. It's not saying, oh, this happened because of me, or anything. It's not about carrying blame, but it's about understanding the part of you that needed that to happen in order to have another experience, and at the end of the day, you'd stopped in terms of your purpose, you'd stopped growing that, you'd stopped, and we all do that through our work on ourselves. There's times where we do that heavily, you know, and then there's other times where we feel like, I just need a break for a minute. But sometimes the breaks that we have last longer than a minute, and then we realize that, oh my God, I really do need to go back to that, because there's a reason that you're here, you know, and it's a, it, everybody that's on this earth has a purpose of some sort, and it's, and when we don't connect with that purpose, we feel like we're lacking in some aspects, some ability to grow, you know. So I think that there's no mistakes in everything that happened for you, so, and it's good that you see it that way, you know, because you see, you really saw it as a wake-up call, and it just, you know, things are meant to grow, and it's like a next level of the relationship with Cam, next level of the relationship with the kids, next level of the relationship with Kaz, you know.
Yeah, and I remember Cam coming into, I was in the hospital, and I was very much like, you know, you need to go, the kids are little, you need to go home. And I sent him home and said, go make sure that the kids are okay. I don't want them to know what's going on until we know. And then at 2 o'clock in the morning, he turned back up and sat next to me in the hospital room and held my hand. And I was just shocked that he was there, and he slept and snored the whole time and I was awake the whole time. But just the fact that he was sitting there next to me, and he said, he looked at me and he said, don't ask me to show this again. You know that it's here now. Don't ask me to show it again. And, you know, that's just like, that's who he is. But I realized in that moment that I was getting everything that, you know, that I wanted. And, you know, it took a big, big thing that I asked for, though, for it, to me to be able to see it, you know, to be able to see and experience it and feel it. And that then catapulted me into, when I got out of hospital, I remember thinking, oh my God, I've got to run off to Ethiopia and feed all the children, and what's my purpose? You know, I need to find it now. But it also made me realize that it's okay not to have just one purpose. Yeah. And, you know, I was trying to pigeon myself into this one purpose because everyone's got this calling, and it wasn't that for me. I love to travel, and I'm now got my own travel business, which is not flourishing at the moment, but it will again. But, you know, but it's okay for me to have a little piece. I like, it's the way I eat too. I like a little taste of everything. And it's okay. That's okay for that to be my calling. And that's what, when I realized that as well and became really okay with that. And that's when my next career launched, and everything with the longest legs and all that stuff kicked off as well.
I think, you know, I think just for the listeners that are there and listening to us talking about a mission statement and how intrinsically linked our mission statement is to our vitality and our energy, and also our, you know, our broadcasting creative capacity. I think that it's important for people to understand that when, you know, when you build a mission statement from a really congruent state with your heart open, where you become congruent with that spiritual quest and that physical quest that we're down here to fulfill, it's not like anything else, you know, it's not like,
so
when you open your heart and you have an experience of a, you know, and a equilibration point where your heart is open and you feel as if you are, you know, this mystical human being, and you're down here having this physical experience and you take responsibility for that. That's really, there's a fundamental difference between the creation of a mission statement from that point as opposed to somebody going, hey, you know, I'm here to change the world.
Absolutely. 100%.
People, when they build a mission statement from that congruent point, you know, they are deeply entangled and they're enmeshed in their physical and spiritual quest. And we all have one here, you know, we all have something to fulfill that is deeply spiritual and deeply physical. And when we let go to that, everything falls into place. And when we resist it, you know, life will, you know, give us a knock, and then it'll, you know, run over us with a fucking Mack truck and say, buddy, you need to fucking wake up. We got shit to do. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I completely agree.
So in terms of where you were career-wise and what you were doing, because your background is in beauty, isn't it?
Correct. Yes. Then, so I was a general therapist. Yeah.
Right. At the time. And so what happened with all of that? And where, like, I know you speak about, because we've got a video of you as well on our website, which is cool. But you speak about the fact that you thought you needed, because For people can't obviously, they can go into the website and have a look later. But for the purpose of the people who are listening, you stand out when you see you because you're so tall, right? Because you I think that would have had a massive impact in terms of how you felt about yourself growing up and how you saw yourself. And it's the beauty industry something that you thought could help you to feel better about yourself, sort of thing?
Yeah, Millsy, that was absolutely why I didn't realize that at the time as well. My, you know, we talk about voids and values, and I definitely had a void in that department. I grew up feeling very unattractive, and I was stood out. You know, I was 6'2" from when I was in grade 6 or year 7. Very, very tall, very, very skinny, freckles, you know, worst hair ever. That was the 80s though.
Everyone had the worst hair then. You should have seen mine.
I had an undercut like and a perm. It was amazing.
Oh.
Yeah.
I also had a perm. But,
yeah, maybe. Yeah, so look, I think I definitely was coming from that place, and that drove me into then wanting to find that beauty and feel beautiful, which then led me to modelling. Obviously, my physique also lent itself to that. But that was a double-edged sword as well because, you know, being in that beauty industry and the modelling industry is so cutthroat for a teenager with body issues. You know, you can go either way. It's on a nice edge. You know, it can either be a positive impact or a negative impact. And obviously it is both of those at once. So it just depends how you come out of that. And I've lost more jobs than I got because of the way I looked, because I was, you know, considered too tall for Australian standards. But I did get, you know, I started a modelling career, and then from that went into the beauty industry. And that's where I was when I had the aneurysm and whatnot. But I was still, you know, looking for that, I guess, validation through my beauty and feeling, you know, that was my purpose and that was how I was getting loved and all that sort of stuff. And it wasn't until after, I guess, that whole thing was, you know, I went through lots and lots of changes that I realized that I was actually not needing that validation anymore because I was feeling like I loved myself. So I didn't need that to be part of my, you know, didn't need to get that validation. So then I didn't need necessarily for that to be filling my cup up. So I was free then to move on to the next thing that I, you know, wanted to challenge myself with.
And you went into travel then, right? So that's when you started.
Yeah, so I went back to school. And
it's funny, just let me go back to the beauty thing though then, because it's funny because listening to that as well, it's a reminder, I suppose, that the things that we perceive are missing in our lives are the things we'll go and do to try and fill those gaps and fill those holes, you know. And like when you don't feel enough and when you don't feel like you look well enough or whatever, you will go and seek out something that either helps other people feel like they look good, or see if you can somehow trick yourself into feeling that you're enough through looking good, you know, and through being a particular way on the outside. And it's really interesting to hear you speak about the fact. I mean, we hear those stories all the time, but your story is cool because it's very you can really see the changes as you've gone through and the different kind of leaps you've made in your consciousness, your awareness about who you are. It's like you asked for that, you know, being the mum of those two little kids and didn't know, and like asking for permission to leave the house, which you know, it's just totally not what you're like now, right? It's just the opposite of you. And to be able to see that transformation and that every single step along the way is kind of like a guiding light to show you that, oh, okay, that's the next lesson I needed to learn. That's the next lesson I needed to learn, you know?
Yeah.
So now you do the travel thing, right? So you're inspired with travel, yeah?
Yeah, absolutely. So I went back to school, but before that I got some opportunity. Once I had the aneurysm and whatnot, then I think I've talked to you, Mills, about the longest legs.
Talk to me about that. I saw you on Snapchat the other day with the subscription. That was
so
cool.
I was asleep on Sunday night, and Zoe comes running in. This is my 18-year-old daughter, comes running into my bedroom, banging on the door, Mum. And I thought the house was on fire. And I
you
said,
made
what
it
is
to Snapchat.
You are on Snapchat's main page.
Shit.
And like, what are you talking about, John? I didn't even know Snapchat had a main page.
Neither did I.
I am on Snapchat, but I didn't know they had a main page.
Neither did I. I was educated through Zoe as well. Go on.
Yeah, so apparently I've made it. If you get on Snapchat made page, that's what you're aiming for.
Wow. Yeah, you're the cool mum for another 5 minutes. So tell everyone about the longest eggs thing and how that came about and where that's taken you.
Well, that came about over a glass of wine, or a few too many glasses of wine, with a girlfriend of mine, and she was reading the paper, and it had these girls in America that were challenging for the longest legs in the world, for the Guinness World Record. And Sal, my girlfriend, said, "You've got them on toast, Heather. You've got to, you know, we've got to send an email." So we would, like, this one eye emailing this reporter saying, "We've got the measuring tape out and these are my measurements." We never heard anything. It was 18 months later, and I got an email from a journalist in America who was asking if they were my actual measurements, because he wants to put me forward for getting the longest legs. And within
the Guinness Book of World Records,
for longest legs. So within a month of that, I had TV crews at my house. I had media all over. I was in a media coaching thing I was on Channel 7. It went crazy. And actually, I don't know if you know this, guys, but I actually got an email late last year, about November, saying, "Are you interested in coming and being on a Japanese TV show?"
I saw the outcome of that. Tell me about that. No, I didn't know that.
Tell us all about it.
Tell us about it.
That was like being on acid in some sort of like the I cannot
ultimate universe.
It was the within 2 weeks of receiving this email, and I had already a trip to Koh Samui. I was going to be in Koh Samui for a month, so I had flights already booked, everything done, and they said, "Oh," and my brother was coming from Canada, so I had no time. There was no window, and it's amazing what you can make happen. They sent me this email, and it sounded a bit sus because they're like, "We want to fly to Japan. We're going to pay for everything, pay you for the interview." So I just went, okay. And then I checked out the company, the production company. It was all checked out. Next minute, I had a TV crew here that they sent from Japan.
What?
Wow.
To film in my house. They did 2 days of filming here. Then they flew me business class and first class from Melbourne to Japan. Wow. Cam took the kids over to Koh Samui. I flew 2 days earlier. I went to Japan. They flew my best friend over with me. We did 3 days of shooting this TV show, and it was the whole thing in Japanese. I didn't even think about that. I don't know why I didn't think about it, but I had an interpreter the whole time, but I had no idea. I was just smiling, looking. I don't know if you've ever seen a Japanese show like these.
Crazy.
Crazy. Yeah.
It's crazy out there as it is. Like, I was out there in 96 and I remember walking around Osaka going, "Fucking hell, I've done some mad shit in my life, but this is just crazy." Like, Japan is
next level. Yeah, it was one of the best experiences of my life. And, you know, you just got to be open to it. And my theory is now you say yes to everything, and just trust that, and that's a big thing is I've learnt to trust in that there's a plan and it's bigger than me, and I just need to let go and have a crack at it, whatever opportunity's in front of me.
Mm-hmm. And did you get to the world record, to the Guinness Book?
Yes. So it's still going on now, can you believe it? It's been going on for, so they've what happened, the girl that's got the record, the Russian woman, she's 51.8 centimetres, mine are 51.5 centimetres, but she's 6'9", so she should have longer legs than me. So then the Guinness have come back and said, "Look, you missed out on that, but we are considering giving you your own world record, which is for ratio of leg to body." So I'm 70% legs, which beats all of them. So if they will accept my application, then I've got the record. So that's been going on for now. They said it'll be up to 4 months, but it's been going on for I don't know how long. And they contacted me last week and said, "We think that we're going to cancel the application because of what's going on," and da da da. And then the radio guy that started it all off just emailed me and said, "No, we're still going to make this happen." So it's still going on now. So it hasn't been
still a process.
Denied yet. So it's still a process. So we'll see what happens.
Oh, so cool. Just let me ask, what exactly were you doing in Japan, though? Was it for a TV show?
It was a variety. It was the number one variety show in Japan.
Right.
And so they got me on. They have a special twice a year. It's on every week, but they have a special show that goes for 2 hours once every year. And I was on their end of year special show, and it was amazing women from all over the world.
Wow.
And they had the girl that was, I was in the green room with, I think her name was Svetlana. She was the biggest bodybuilder in the world. And my God, she was amazing.
Huge.
Incredible.
Wow.
But yeah, it was an amazing experience.
So it's funny then that it's, well, not funny, it's cool, but that fact that, you know, because this thing with your height and this thing with standing out and not, you know, now has become like a source of attraction or a source of, you know, like empowerment. I think, you know, I speak to a lot of tall girls and I use your story as an example, but I see a lot of tall people shrinking, like cowering down and making their height less so that they feel less imposing. One particular girl I remember speaking to about this in particular, and I used your example that you actually wear heels, you know, you don't care about that anymore. I know you would have, but can you just tell me a little bit about that and the transition there for you?
Yeah, well, for a long time, I guess, my dad was a very big influence in making me stand up tall and be proud of my height. But for a long time, and even just, you know, when you're on a daily basis, when you're a teenager and you're talking with your peers, you hunch down just to be on their level. You know, it's just when you're, just to be in the eyesight. And so, you know, it's nature trying to, you know, it feels like they're trying to pull you down. So trying to fight against that and just, you know, just have a conversation with people and stand up and be, but even now, you know, I know myself having a conversation, I have to look down physically. I'm looking down at people if I'm standing up. But it took a long time for me to, I would never, you know, I'd worn heels, not a chance. And, you know, my husband Cam, he's the same height as me, but I absolutely love wearing heels now, only that the fact that I, it hurts my back now because I'm getting old. But and my son, Cooper, who's 16, he's 6'9".
Is he?
So he towers over me, Yeah, it's 208 centimetres or something now. Wow. And, you know, his height, there was a wind. He's always been so proud of his height. But anywhere we go now, whether people know us or don't know us, that's the first thing that he gets asked as well is, oh, my God, how tall are you? Do you play basketball? Like, that's just standard issue questions, you know. Yeah. And I've watched him go through that now and watched it from the outside as well. That was my childhood. And now I'm watching him go through it. I'm watching the process of that. And I feel like I've been able to give him some skills with that because I can give him my perspective on it. And I've seen a little bit of a wobble for the first time. It was probably last year where he was like, no, I don't want anyone else to ask me about my height. I don't want to, you know, be this. But it was only a very short period of time. But he loves being tall, you know, and he embraces it. And
I think that this is where the lineage is important now, you know, because if it comes about in a way where we can take on our parents' lopsided perceptions about possibly how to be, you know, and what we're expected to be, we can also pass down our clarity and our certainty and our understanding about ourselves, you know. And if you can pass down something to your kids, you know, and I know Coop, for example, because he's tall, I know Zoe's tall, but she's not like as tall as you guys. Whereas, you know, with your son, to be able to share your understanding and your experience of that and being able to communicate that to him through just energetically, the fact that you're okay with yourself and that you don't have to cower down and you don't have to stoop to, you know, communicate to people. I think that's really, really important, you know. And I think go on.
Yeah, I was just going to say, you know, in terms of we also talk about naturally getting it, naturally understanding, and like his brain, he naturally, and whether or not that's to do with the lineage and what I've, you know, passed on to him, Zoe's done the work, you know, with you guys.
Yeah.
And I don't think naturally her brain didn't necessarily go that way, but even she has been able to communicate the way that we communicate in our house. It's that language, and he just naturally gets it, you know. And I don't know whether that's definitely a combination of everything, you know, whether he's born that way, but he just naturally goes, that's his brainwave, and he just gets shit. He's just crazy and he just gets it, you know.
Yeah, and I think that I honestly think that that's in large part credit to you and to Cam, because you could have sat back and not got those aspects of yourself at the end of the day. And, you know, it's really heartening to see that has happened, you know, for his sake and for your sake, you know.
Yeah.
I see pictures. I love a picture of you and your mum where she's tucked under her arm, you know, so tiny.
Yeah.
So I think we're ready to kind of finish up, but I just probably want to ask you, out of everything in your life right now in this moment, Kaz, what do you think you're the most grateful for? What's the biggest lesson you've learned? What do you think you're most grateful for?
I would say I'm the most grateful for being able to be given the gift to be able to have myself and love myself and own who I am and be okay with the bits and be okay with not being okay. And, you know, important. That for me is not, you know, not trying to control every facet and having the skills to be able to do that and having the skills to draw upon. And sometimes, you know, don't get me wrong, I have shit days just like everyone else and I have fights with my husband and I have moments, as you know, Mills, where I've rang you going, I am no good at this parenting thing. This is shit. And, you know, but then when you, you know, to be able to, when I am in despair, to know that I can just sit back and the ability to be able to go, I actually am going to be okay and I know this is going to be okay and I just need to let go and you know, have some skills to be able to reflect and look back at that. I just, there's no amount of money or anything in the world that, it's given me the gift of my life as it looks now, which is perfect. So they're like perfect and imperfect at the same time, you know, and no one can take that away from me either, you know. That's,
I think that's amazing. That's a really magic point, you know, that whole concept of being okay with not being okay. You know, I think it's, you know, it's the one of the ultimate outcomes is to be able to be in that place that it, you know, you don't know all the answers and that's okay. You don't, it's, you haven't got the remedy and that's okay, but everything's going to be okay because you know that, you know, that's once you have that knowing, no one can take it from you. It's great work.
Yeah.
Kaz, we really appreciate your time. We love you. It's, I love talking to you every time I get a chance to talk to you. It's, I love listening to your story. I love that you share your story. And, yeah, we really appreciate you taking the time to have a chat with us and to share some of that with the people listening today. So thank you so, so much.
Thanks, Paul.
It's always a pleasure. Thank you. Love you both.
See you, mate. Take care.
If you found this information inspiring, make sure you subscribe and tune in to the next Dorothy and the Dealer podcast.